Hey everyone, we hope you guys are staying safe and healthy during the current pandemic. In case you missed our note on our YouTube community page, we are back in Austin at my parents' house. Well, we're currently in the van in my parents' driveway until it's safe for us to travel again.
Yeah, and we've really missed vlogging, but we've been stuck inside, didn't know what to film, our creative juices are kind of limited. So we asked you guys on Instagram and YouTube for some ideas, and I think we have enough to carry us for the next couple weeks, maybe a couple months, but oh, please, hopefully not any longer than that.
We're going a bit stir crazy. Yeah. So our vlogs will look different for the foreseeable future. We'll be doing a mix of Q&A videos, some quarantine adventures, as well as some van life content. So if you guys have anything you want to see, just comment below and let us know and we'll try to make it happen.
Yeah, and you've already sent us a bunch of questions already on a variety of different topics. So we're gonna kind of try to break them out into specific videos. And this one, first up, we're gonna start with some general questions about just how we travel.
This is our first ever Q&A video.
Yeah, feels, I don't know, I'm excited.
It'll be different because it's going to be us talking different the whole time. Yeah. So if you hate just watching us and talking the whole time, you may not like this video.
Just put some, put the phone down and just listen.
Yeah, maybe it'll be like a podcast. Yeah, yeah. So we will put some timestamps in the description below with the questions we are answering and then what time we're actually going to discuss those things. Mm-hmm. So if you only want to hear about a few things or you're limited on time, go and check that out. We'll also put a link to any blog posts or resources that we mention in the description below. But let's get started. Question number one, how do we choose our next destination?
So choosing where we want to go when we're in the van, it's a tough mix between going to the places that we know and love and exploring those more deeply and seeing all the little towns around that versus going to somewhere brand new that we've never seen. But there's two things that kind of guide our decision is, one, we want to see all 50 states, and two, we want to see all the national parks. And so that kind of weighs heavily on our decision for when we're in the van traveling around the United States.
Yeah, so it makes the van decisions a little bit easier. Like, we were supposed to be going up the East Coast until about May, but our plans have changed, obviously, so that's not happening. But we had never really explored that area, so that was our big priority for, like, the first half of 2020.
And also, when we built the van, we built it to kind of chase the sun, chase the good weather. So we didn't plan on being in Colorado in the snow and ice. So that's what we're trying to do. We were in Florida for the, you know, the winter. And so,
yeah, we're trying to chase good weather for a lot of reasons. So we'll, you know, tend to plan out our travel schedule based on, you know, where what the weather is that time of year. Not too hot, not too cold. Mm-hmm. So we do have some notes. So if you see us looking, we just don't want to forget
we
anything.
We want to thoroughly answer this.
Yeah, so we want to answer the questions the best we can and not forget anything. Yeah. So for flying trips, so international or Hawaii, it's definitely harder because there's so much more places to explore. I mean, in the van, we're stuck with Canada and the U.S. mostly, but beyond that, the whole world is our oyster. So figuring out where we want to go in the rest of the world is really hard. Mm-hmm. But one thing that plays a huge factor is my job. So I'll touch on what I do for work later, but there are certain times of the year that are easier for me to travel. That's the summer, and then typically like mid-November to New Year's, it's usually easier for me to take some time off. So we'll look at what places are good to travel to during that time. We'll also look for good flight deals. So if we find a really good flight deal, we will consider going to that place. So we kind of have like a running list of places that we want to prioritize. And if we find a good flight deal, if it's a good time of year to visit that place, we will go there. We also, you know, if there's a certain thing we want to see, like if we want to go to Glacier National Park, there's a very small window where you can actually drive this one road. So we'd prioritize that for that specific time of the year. One example of a trip that we took and how we made that decision was Mexico City.
Yeah, we were watching
TV,
YouTube, I think, and we were just like, man, I really want some tacos, you know, and we were looking up flight deals for Mexico City and they looked good, and I think we booked them, I don't know if we booked them that night, but that week,
that
right?
That was probably like our most spontaneous trip. We had never planned to go to Mexico City at that point in time, and then we wanted tacos, so we booked it and we went.
Like, let's go. What is our travel planning process or tools that we use, and do we plan out a trip or do we just wing it? We are definitely more planners versus spontaneous travelers, so we want to pack in our days as much as we can so that we can get the most out of the place that we're trying to experience. But as we've traveled more, we're trying to leave in a little bit more room to be spontaneous, and so this can save you some time and some money. So for example, if you're looking to do an activity and you look ahead of time, sometimes you can save a couple of bucks. And then also a big one is say you're walking around town and you're really hungry, but you don't know where to go, and you just kind of walk into any old place. It might be great, it might not be great, and if it's bad, you're not going to be satisfied. So it's good to plan ahead, especially for food, I think.
It saves you from that food heartbreak when you're very hangry, or from wandering around for hours and just wasting time trying to figure out where to eat. So when we figure out what destination we want to go to next, the first thing that we kind of do from a planning perspective is start tracking flights on Google Flights. We love Google Flights because you can track the exact routes you want. So if you're, you know, picky on the airline, or if you don't want to have like really long layovers, you can pick the exact flights you want and then just see how the prices are going. We also love a tool called FareDrop. It's built by this YouTube couple we love, Kara and Nate, and basically you put your home airport options. So we've put all the major ones in Texas, and then kind of where you want to go to in the future, what months you'd like to travel, kind of a price point, and then they send you awesome deals. We get so many deals. We have yet to book one just because of my work schedule, but we're always getting deals that just torture us. So the next step for our travel planning process is just research. We love Pinterest. Pinterest is how we found a lot of bloggers that we like, actually. And you can just find some really high quality blogs on Pinterest, get a good like locals perspective, as well as a perspective of someone who spent a lot of time in a place. A lot of people have found our blogs on Pinterest, so that's really cool. So we just read a bunch of blogs and we try to find like common themes. So if everyone's recommending you need to go eat here or you need to go here, we definitely write it down. It definitely gets like a higher priority on our list. We also love like the usual suspects, Yelp, TripAdvisor, and Google reviews. We found that Google reviews are used more globally than Yelp or TripAdvisor. So depending on where we're going, we'll read all three. We'll read just a couple of them and try to find places that are both like the must visit popular place with thousands of reviews, as well as those places that have way less reviews but tons of great reviews that are kind of like a hidden gem or maybe a local spot. So we try to find a mix of those. We look at a lot of YouTube vlogs to get ideas of things to do when we're going places. For trails, we look at All Trails. It's a, in our experience, a pretty like globally used tool, and it basically tells you how far a hike is, the elevation gain. People write reviews so you can see current conditions. Some destinations we go to have their own sites, like Washington has the Washington Trails Association, which gives you reviews from people who live in Washington, and it's just sometimes more up to date and sometimes more detailed than All Trails. We also like to use Instagram. So if you are on Instagram and you like search in like Yosemite National Park, for example, you can typically see, you know, recent stories and posts from people who have been, and you can see more of the current conditions, what things look like.
Yeah, it's more helpful like right before, maybe a couple days before you're going to do like hikes and things like that.
So you can see if the trees are all dead or if it's icy, or in like a city, for example, you can look up a place you want to go to and you can see, oh, it's all under construction. So you're not surprised when you get there. That's happened to us a few times, and like an iconic thing has been under construction. So sometimes Instagram helps you see like the most up-to-date version of what things look like. So after we've made a list of everything we want to see and do, we start to look at Google Maps and we plug in all the places we want to go to. We figure out, you know, what things make sense to group together. So we're not trying to go all around town in one day. We like to stick to certain areas, so that's how we figure out like what our itinerary will look like. And then we have this itinerary Google sheet. This sounds like such a long process. It is a hard long process.
I mean, we do
it's
it
a
like
lot of work.
Months in advance most of the time.
So we have a Google sheet that we use to map out our itinerary. It's such a tongue twister, man. We're talking a lot already. I'm getting all tongue-tied. So we have this Google itinerary or Google Sheet itinerary we use. We actually have it on our website. You can download it and make a copy and start using it for all of your trips. And it's maybe more detailed than some people would like, but for us, it's nice to kind of figure out, you know, what time we plan to get places, how long they'll take, how to get there, anything you need to know, like cash only. So we keep track of all of that in a sheet, and that just kind of becomes our like go-to doc when we're on that trip.
Yeah, and like we mentioned at the beginning, anything we mention will be linked in the description below so you can see it and use it yourself.
How do you stay fit while traveling?
So we get this question a lot on our, like, specifically our food tour videos, but outside of our videos, we're eating healthy like 5 to 6 days out of the week. Like, I would say at least 80% of our meals throughout the week are healthy, and you guys only see stuff that we really indulge in, the barbecue, the biscuits, the gelato, and stuff like that. So outside of that, we're eating well, and we typically do like 2 meals a day.
Yeah, we have a rule that we don't eat out unless we're filming a vlog, because that helps us save money and be healthier. So the only times we eat out is when we're filming a vlog for you guys. Yeah. So you guys don't see like the boring meals we eat, but I promise you we eat healthy. But it's always funny when we post like a food stuffing our face vlog. People are like, how the heck are you eating all this all the time? But we're not. That's the trick.
Yeah, and we, as far as working out, we try to work out 3 to 5 times a week. And so if you've seen our van tour video, you've seen that we have these adjustable dumbbells. To be honest, we've only used them twice on the road, but we'll use them more, and we've used them a lot during the quarantine, obviously, since we can't go to the gym. But we have a Planet Fitness membership that we use quite frequently, because there's so many locations everywhere, and it's nice and easy. So.
Yeah, and for workouts, we like doing a lot of weight stuff, so like weight training and like high intensity interval training, HIIT training. So we love weights. We're not really big cardio people. Yeah. We're trying to learn to run during this time.
Running has been the bane of my entire existence of my life. But
yeah, so we love to work out. We do eat healthy, we promise. And you guys get to see all the fun food. And trust us, when we finally get to have that fun food on the weekend, we go ham. Why it looks like we're crazy and we eat bad all the time.
Which Hawaiian island do you enjoy the most for food, for beaches, for hiking and activities?
We're really bad at favorite questions.
Yeah, it's tough.
We always say we love the islands equally but differently. And trying to figure out what we were going to say for this question was very hard.
Yeah, but we
can say all of them.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, you can get all this stuff on all the islands. They're all just magical. But for food, we decided, we kind of agreed that Oahu is kind of the best for food. I think you just get the biggest variety, and it's like the highest kind of quality.
Yeah, it's
right?
Like there's a bigger city there. So yeah. I feel like maybe the bars pretty high, and there's more restaurants to choose from. Yeah. So we're gonna go with Oahu on that one, but we've had great food on every island. For beaches, my favorite beach is this beach called, I think it's like Secret Beach on Maui, so it might have another name too, but it's this tiny it's this tiny little cove. It's just so beautiful. It's just what I think of when I think of a beautiful beach. It has like rocks and palm trees and beautiful water, so I'm gonna give the edge to Maui just because my favorite beach is there. But I think we'd agree, like, Maui has a ton of beaches. I feel like all the beaches are really nice too.
Yeah, for sure. On the island of Hawaii, there's different colored ones.
Yeah.
More of them. I mean, you kind of have some on all the islands, right? But
on Maui, yeah.
On the big island is where you'll get like green sand and stuff like that. So
depends on what you want. If you want the beautiful beach, you can't go wrong with any. But we're gonna pick Maui because we have to pick one.
Yeah. And for hiking, we chose Kauai. It's the island that's the most like untouched kind of, and has kind of the most nature that's more abundant and easy to get to, I guess.
And there's
just a ton of hikes.
Yeah, there's the Nepali coast.
Yeah,
and there's Waimea Canyon. So there's just unique hikes there. Yeah. And I don't know, we're actually writing a Kauai guide right now that will be out. It'll be out by the time this is posted. And just reliving that trip it was not vlogged. So if you're looking for a Kauai vlog, we'll have to go back and film one. But
yeah, we'll do the work for you.
Man, well, we'll just go back to Kauai. But yeah, the hikes there are epic. And then I guess the last one is activities.
Yeah, so we couldn't choose one. So we chose the Big Island and then also Maui. The Big Island, there's a volcano. You can snorkel with manta rays.
Waterfalls.
I mean, you have waterfalls in all of them, but there's just awesome ones there. And then we also chose Maui. There's the Road to Hana, which is a pretty unique thing, and it's a classic fun thing to do. It's an all-day thing, so if you're going to do it, be prepared, but it's awesome. There's also Haleakala, which that's the one where you go up, and early in the morning, you can get above the clouds to check out the sunrise, and we've tried to do it twice, and it hasn't worked out so great. We're gonna go back and try to do it again one day. And apparently Maui is the best island for whale watching.
Yeah, we went whale watching there. It was so fun. Yeah. We'll probably throw some clips up of our whale watching trip while we're talking. To give y'all a break from our faces. But yeah, we haven't vlogged Maui either, so we definitely need to go back to Maui and Kauai to make some vlogs for you guys, because our Hawaii vlogs have probably been our most popular vlogs out of all the ones we've done, so we'll go back. We love it there. How do we manage money and save money to travel? I guess we'll start off and explain what we actually do for work. So we're not full-time vloggers or bloggers. We wish we could be because we could film so many more vlogs, but I have a full-time corporate job. It's for a tech company that's 100% remote, so everyone works from home. I've been working this job over a year and a half now, so even before we hit the road in the van, and I'm an events manager, so I travel a good amount for work, going to different trade shows and conferences, but I do have a full-time job, which is nice because that gives us like one consistent salary as well as like health insurance, 401k, and all those other perks.
Yep, and right before we moved into the van, I started a freelance web design business, Mana Web Design, where I build websites for small businesses. So as we're traveling, it's easy for us, when you're full-time traveling anyways, it's easy for us to kind of get in that vacation mode where we go to a city and we just want to explore it like we always do, but we have to remember that we're not on vacation and we kind of got to slow down and try to live as cheaply as we can.
Yeah, so we try to, like we said earlier, we cook a lot of meals, we try not to eat out, we try to work at places that are free, like libraries, even going to like a coffee shop and getting the cheapest thing that adds up a lot over time. Mm-hmm. We try to sleep for free at night, and we try to do like free activities. So our like fun days are the days we vlog. So on the weekends, we try to actually explore the town and, you know, splurge a little bit. I think we've been splurging a little bit too much, to be honest. So we're going to try to cut back a bit on how much we're eating because we are trying to save money. But our income went down like 35% when we hit the road in the van. We do make some money off of YouTube and our blog. So we have that income, which is pretty inconsistent. We have Adam's income, which as a freelancer, it's more inconsistent. And then we have my income, which is the consistent one. So although our expenses did go down a bit in the van, our income also did too. So we are on a budget. We're trying really hard to save money for a few different things. So yeah, we can't pretend we're on vacation 24/7.
Yeah, and as far as our finances or how we break it up, I guess, so we have a travel fund and then two other savings accounts. And so for our travel fund, is that's what we use for when we travel. So if we go overseas, like say we take a trip to London, we have all this money set aside and budgeted out for what we plan for. And so the trip is kind of already kind of paid for. It's already taken out of our other income, basically.
Yeah. So when we get back from a trip, like a flying trip, we add up how much money we spent during that trip, and then we just take that money out of the trip fund and just pay off the trip. So we also have a few other things that we do to kind of save money to travel and while we're traveling. We also have 4 travel credit cards, and we know that credit cards can kind of be a controversial topic, but we treat ours like debit cards, so whatever we spend on them per month, we pay it off in full every single month. So it's like a debit card for us, except we get way more benefits than a traditional debit card. So we have the Chase Sapphire Reserve, which is our favorite one. We have the Amex Platinum, we have the Alaska Airlines credit card, and the Capital One Venture card. And when we've signed up for these, we've gotten really nice sign-on bonuses or yearly perks that help us travel easier or cheaper. We haven't really paid for a flight in a really long time. One of our favorite perks of the travel credit cards are the lounges.
Oh yeah.
So when at some airports, they have lounges that we can get access to, and that just saves us a ton of money at the airport.
Yeah, you don't have to buy the food that's in the main terminal and coffee and all that. Yeah, so it comes with a lot of perks, and it's just nice to have your own quiet space to be
outlets.
In the airport.
Outlets are hard at airports sometimes, so that's probably our favorite perk.
Yeah, the biggest thing to remember with the travel cards, though, is make sure you pay them off every month so you're avoiding the large interest rate, and then also making sure you're meeting the minimum spend amount in that first couple months to get that big reward. Point reward.
My brother just told us the other day he missed he missed the bonus by $5 because he got confused and thought he had met it and he didn't. So
that's painful.
Oh, my heart. Yeah. We also use Airbnb credits to help us travel cheaper. So in the description of every YouTube video and then on pretty much every blog post that we create, we have this link you can use. So if it's your first time using Airbnb and you use our link to book your stay, you get $40 USD off your first Airbnb, and then we get a little bit as well. It's like around $20 or so. And that's helped us. We've had a lot of people who have watched our videos, I guess, use it.
Because, way more than we ever thought.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool.
And we've been able to stay at Airbnbs for free or for a pretty significant discount for a while. So thank you to everyone who's used that link.
You're helping us out a lot.
Yeah, you're helping us, and hopefully we're helping you.
Yeah.
And the cool thing about it, though, is anyone can use or have a link. You don't have to be like a travel vlogger or blogger. So you can get your link on your profile on Airbnb and refer it to your friends, to family members, anyone you know who has not used Airbnb, and you'll get money off your stay too.
We also have a blog post with all of these tips and a couple of others that'll help you out on your next travel.
We probably should update it during this free time. It's a little outdated, so yeah. We'll work on that. But for our next question, we have a very special guest joining us. Kona's here! She decided to join us for this part of the vlog. Yeah. She just played ball inside, so she's very hyped up right now. Oh, yeah. And the question is, what is it like traveling with a dog, and what do you do when you go to a place or a trail that doesn't allow dogs?
First of all, we love having Kona with us, but she can be a bit stressful. So
just having a dog in general, traveling in a van or however, it's just like an extra thing you have to think about, like temperature and where you're going and just making sure the dog's always safe.
Yeah. So we always have to make sure the temperature, if it's not too hot outside, too cold. If it is too hot, luckily the van, it kind of stays a little bit cooler than a regular car because we have all the windows usually, covered
and up. We have insulation in here and stuff.
It's insulated in here. So we keep an eye on that. If it's too cold outside, we have a heater, so we keep the heater running, and her crate is right by the heater, so she's nice and comfy.
And I don't know if you mentioned this, but we have a temperature sensor with our SimpliSafe, with our SimpliSafe, we can keep an eye on her with the camera, but we also have a temperature sensor so we can see how hot it actually is in the van.
The SimpliSafe is fun too because you get to just spy on her. Yeah. I think you can talk through. I haven't done it yet, but she'd probably go crazy if we did. But yeah, we don't like to get too far from the van. Like say we're in a coffee shop, we want to park as close as we can so we can keep an eye on it, things like that.
So especially when she's in the van, like we don't want to be far from her. Yeah. And we come and check on her all the time.
Yeah, every hour or so when we're working. But if we're going on a hike that's a few hours long.
Or like a national park, or if we have like a full day where we definitely cannot have her with us.
Yeah, we'll get an Airbnb.
So a lot of people would probably get a dog sitter. But Kona, as we've said a few times in other vlogs, like she had to go to a pretty intensive training. She has a lot of behavioral issues. Mm-hmm. And we've learned a lot of tools to help manage life with her better and help her not feel so scared of everything. Mm-hmm. So teaching all of that to a random sitter in a random town would just be way too hard.
Yeah, we can't expect someone brand new to be able to figure it out because it's a lot of things you got to keep in your mind, like just in case something happens. So
for us, it's just easier to get an Airbnb and just spend that money and have like a safe, air conditioned, comfy place for her to hang out. Mm-hmm. But thankfully, we don't have to do that too much. Yeah. One other thing that people ask kind of frequently is like, oh, where's Kona? Like, why isn't she in the vlog? And the answer is, it's just too stressful to film and have her with us at the same time. Most of the time, we just have to really, with her training, we have to focus on her. Like all of our attention has to be focused on her, but we also want to focus on the vlog and make a good vlog. And so we can't put our full focus on both at the same
time. Yeah, it's just too much because somebody's got to film stuff. Somebody's got to take pictures and make sure we're going to the right place, things like that. And so if no one's watching her and making sure that she's okay,
that's when she'll start barking at things and being crazy.
Yeah, I mean, we've had her. She's almost 7 now, right?
Ooh, 6 and a half, yeah.
Yeah, and so you'd think we'd have her figured out by now, but
she's a difficult one.
We think she's going to react a certain way to something, and sometimes she's cool with it, and sometimes she goes off the rails. So we just have to pay attention.
So for us, it's less stressful to vlog without her, but we're hoping to incorporate her in more vlogs in the future. Yeah. Right, Kona?
Oh, yeah.
Do you want to be in more vlogs? Aww. Aww. Do you want to give daddy kisses? Aww. Say bye. Bye.
What are your recommendations of things to do in Utah? So our experience in Utah has mainly been at the national parks, so Zion and Bryce Canyon National Park. Zion is one of our absolute favorite national parks, and the big highlight for us, one of them, is the Narrows. And so that's, you're basically hiking down this river with these giant cavern walls on the sides, and the water's like knee deep, and you get to rent these like ankle boots that they're like waterproof, and so it gives you better grip on the water. So much fun to do, and you get to get a cane to walk down the river.
It was the best.
Yeah, but something to remember with that is it can flood oftentimes, and so you want to make sure and look ahead and make sure it's not flooding before you go.
So you're not heartbroken when you get there and you can't do it.
Yeah, and then our other highlight there, oftentimes people think of Angel's Landing about Zion, but we haven't done it just for a variety of reasons, mainly the crowds.
And it seems scary to me. I don't like drop-offs. Yeah. It has a lot of drop-offs. You have to like hold on to these chains or ropes to get to the top, so it just didn't sound like something I would enjoy.
Yeah, and so our alternative to that, and we think is a way better alternative, is a hike called Observation Point. It's, you get a higher view, it's not as sketchy to get to, and there's way less people. It's a bit more challenging of a hike, probably.
I don't know if it's more challenging. I think it's less scary, so it might be longer,
yeah.
But it's higher up. Yeah. So, yeah,
you get a similar view, but from above, and you can see Angel's Landing down below, and it's a way better hike.
We haven't done Angel's Landing, yeah. But we went Memorial Day weekend, so a busy time to go, mm-hmm. And it really wasn't that crowded at Observation Point, but we had heard from others that there was a line on the chains portion of Angel's Landing to get to the top, so people are having to wait in line for like an hour to even get to the top of the hike.
No thanks.
Yeah, that doesn't sound fun. So check out Observation Point. It is awesome.
Yeah.
And then Bryce Canyon, so we did both of them in the same trip. Our biggest tip is Bryce Canyon is colder. It's higher elevation than Zion. We, for some reason, thought that the temperature would be the same at both.
It's all Utah,
like,
right?
Oh, we'll look up Zion weather. Let's just pack for Zion.
No, we learned the hard way. I'm in shorts and it's freezing degrees outside. It was so cold.
Yeah. And we slept in this teepee thing on the ground, and it had no heat or anything. So, yeah, it was a little brutal. So bring warmer clothes for Bryce Canyon. Mm-hmm. But Bryce was awesome. Oh, it was way less busy than Zion. Mm-hmm. Like, hardly any people.
Yeah.
We did a Sunrise Point, mm-hmm. I believe, for sunrise. That was beautiful. Yeah. We did the Fairyland Loop.
Yeah.
I'm going to cheat on our notes.
Sorry, we're cheating.
Fairyland Loop, which is less busy than the main one, which is like the Navajo and Queen's Garden. Definitely do both, but the Fairyland Loop, we hardly saw any people the whole time, and takes you through all the hoodoos and stuff.
Yeah, it's fun.
It was really fun.
So we have a guide on both of these national parks. We'll link to it below again. And another thing to note is we flew into Las Vegas when we came and then drove up, but we passed through this town called St. George, and there is a Mexican taco spot that you have to stop. I'm going to cheat for the name. It's La Cocina Mexican Street Food, but it's in like an old Sonic, and so you drive up. I think you walked in.
Yeah,
right?
You like sit in like this little outdoor patio. Yeah. But yeah,
you get these little street tacos. They're so
we ate like
good.
20. Yeah, they were amazing.
They were good. And then we've also been to Moab. Moab's super cool. It's a van life mecca. There's like more vans there than dogs, it feels like. But there's a place called Moab Garage Co. You can pick up your coffee there. They have great breakfast, you know, burritos, pancakes, all that stuff. So.
Yeah, so we've been to Moab a few times, mostly driving through. We mm-hmm. did spend a few days there in November, and we did not go to Arches. We have yet to go to Arches. Yeah. Just timing wise, it didn't work out. It wasn't in the cards for this mm-hmm. year. So hopefully we'll go sometime soon, but we hear Arches and the parks around are amazing, but Moab's a pretty cool little town too. What creates the most tension for y'all when traveling? Ooh, we're getting into the juicy drama.
So you would think living in a small van, moving all the time, that we'd always be bumping into each other and getting frustrated like that. But we actually love the van. It's the perfect size. No regrets there. It's perfect. The biggest stressor is all the work we have. So Catherine, she has her regular 9-to-5. That's 40 hours a week that she works hard at. But then we also have the blog and vlog and everything that comes with that, which is 40 hours or more every week that she just works her absolute tail off, and I take my hat off to her. She's a workaholic, and
it's not a good thing. I'm trying to get better.
Yeah, so we've got that stressor, but then also my life is obviously completely different. I was a teacher, and we lived in an apartment, so I have unstable at-home environment, moving around all the time, and then my day-to-day 9-to-5, you know, is completely different. And
just trying to grow your business.
Yeah,
it's
I'm
stressful.
Doing web design, and it's I'm getting the hang of it, but it's still new to me. So, and I'm learning how to run my own business and be my own boss and all that. So that just,
So we'll both get like stressed out about our own work, mm-hmm. and then we just get frustrated and kind of let it out on each other. So we're trying to get better at this by doing something fun every day. We hardly ever take breaks. Like even filming a vlog is a lot of work. Like we're, you know, trying to plan out what we're going to do, have facts and important things we want to make sure mm-hmm. we say. You know, we go into a coffee shop and instead of just sitting there and drinking it, we like film everything and, you know, it's just a lot of work.
Like, we have like a piece of pizza or something. We got to take pictures of it. Then we've got to talk about where we are and what it is. And then it's getting cold, and then when we finally bite and tell you how it is, it's
probably cold.
Probably like not the same as if we sat down and took a bite, how it's supposed to be. And then we're talking to the camera, and the lady at the table next to us is like staring at us.
So
like,
we feel awkward.
What are you doing?
So yeah, vlogging is a lot of work in itself. So I mean, if we're working 15-hour days, 5 days a week, and then we're vlogging 2 days a week, we really don't get like a break to just breathe. So it's been really important for us to do something fun every day, even if it's just like 10 minutes or an hour. And we're not trying to say like vlogging isn't fun. We have so much fun. It's just more work than it might let on. So for us, you know, going on a walk with Kona or just getting a break from our computers, you know, every day during the week puts us in just a better headspace to be able to film vlogs on the weekend and have a lot of fun. We also are trying to not force ourselves to film anything or do anything if we're not, like, excited about it or if we're too burnt out or tired.
But on the other side of that, it can cause its own stress because, like you said, we only have 1 or 2 days to vlog every week. And if we don't do it 1 week, we're kind of out of content, video content for that week. We don't get too far ahead just because of the limited time we have. So if we don't film a vlog, we're kind of out of luck on YouTube for a week.
Yeah, but we're trying to, like, be okay with that because our mental health and taking breaks, that's more important than publishing a vlog as much as we love doing it.
Yeah.
So we're just trying to really listen to how we feel, and if we don't feel like we're in the mood to go out and do anything big that day, we'll just lay low and relax and sleep, and that's okay. So that's really helping us kind of overcome any tension in our relationship.
Because, I mean, if we're stressed at the max every day, like, the vlog's not going to be good anyways.
Yeah, there's many vlogs y'all haven't seen because they haven't gone well, so we stopped filming.
Yeah, it sucks, but we'll go back around and do it again.
We'll hit up those places again.
What is our favorite places we have ever visited and why?
As we said, we're really bad at favorite questions because we love everything. Maybe we're just too easy to please, but we just get excited and love everything we do.
Mm-hmm.
But I'd have to say Italy as a whole was my favorite trip we've ever been on because it was a mix of city, beaches, mountains, small towns, awesome food, gelato. It was just the perfect combination of everything we love. Specifically, though, the Dolomites was my favorite part of that trip. It was just crazy beautiful. We had the best Airbnb hosts. The towns were super cool. It was just amazing. And then I also loved Matera. So that was that small cave town we visited, and it was just really unique and different. And we had a local named Silvio. Shout out to Silvio. We still talk to him on Instagram. He's the best. He took us around, and that just having a local experience was just amazing.
Yeah, that's something we want to look into more in the future. But yeah, this is a really hard question. We've been to a lot of places, but I mean, on the grand scheme of things, we haven't been anywhere really. But so I've kind of recently decided that if someone really asked me what my favorite city was, I'm going to say Vancouver, British Columbia. It's just, it has like an awesome city vibe. You get out of the city, there's tons of nature. There's even nature in the city with Stanley Park, and it's just absolutely beautiful. But then, like, there's the Sea to Sky Highway that takes you up northwest. It's just unreal. The food is so good.
Yeah.
The mountains, the lakes, waterfalls, everything is just awesome. But then I've always wanted to go to Europe, and so we finally did. We've been twice, you know, the UK and Italy, but the Italy trip, yeah, I'm on the same boat as that. Like, all the history that's all around, you just don't have that in the United States. And the food, the gelato, the hikes, the mountains, all the, I said the history already, but it's just, it just made me want to go back even more.
We're dying to go back to Europe.
Can't wait.
What are your thoughts on settling down someday? So this is a hard question for us to answer, and we talk about this all the time, but I guess the short answer is we have no idea. Like, 2 years ago, we had no idea we'd be traveling full-time in a van. We were trying to maybe buy a house in Seattle, and even before we moved to Seattle, we were trying to build a house in Austin, so our interests and, like, our life goals, they've just changed a lot since we've been married.
Yeah, it's kind of scary but exciting at the same time. You know, you take it all the way back to our beginning in Austin. We wanted a house, kids, then we moved to Seattle, wanted a house and all that. And then it just changed year to year. And so it's kind of scary and exciting, like I said, that what are we going to want in a year from
we
now?
We have no idea. Like, what's next?
Yeah, like 2.5 years ago, if you said we were in a van, like,
no way.
I don't know about
or
that.
Or then we built it ourselves, we'd be like, okay.
Definitely no way then. So,
but, I mean, I'm sure one day we'll want to have a steady home base. And we still, regardless of what we end up doing from, like, a living situation, we want to travel as much as we can for the rest of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
But we see ourselves doing this for at least a few more years. Like, we are not sick of it yet.
No.
There's so many places we want to visit. We always say, like, the best is yet to come, and we truly believe that. Like, we're just getting started on this adventure.
Yeah.
And if we decide to have kids someday, we hope that we can travel as a family and do stuff with our kids. We don't ever see travel not being a part of our life, but yeah, we have no idea what we're even doing tomorrow at this point, so it's hard for us to say.
Yeah, we're absolutely loving our situation right now. I can't wait to get back out there once everybody's healthy and all that. And but the kind of the big thing with it's a big question with kids is our running joke, even when we first got married, was, oh, when are you gonna have kids? And we've always said in 3 years. And
well, that was almost 6 years ago.
Yeah, and we still say that in about 3 years.
So, yeah, I don't know. If any of you are curious if we're having kids,
that's your,
we probably will, but we still have some time.
That's the answer you're going to get.
Kona's enough of a child for us right now.
Where do you want to go next?
So we were supposed to be going to Peru, and we'd be there like 2 months from now. Yeah. We were partnering with a company and doing this two-week trip, doing cities, a five-day trek to Machu Picchu. We were going to do so many cool things. We are very...
It's still on for now.
It's on for now, but we're not very confident it'll happen.
It's not trending in the right direction.
Yeah, we don't think we're going to get to go. So if we could pick anywhere to go next, it would be there. Mm-hmm. We're hoping that we can reschedule the trip and maybe just do it on our own in the fall. We just really want to go there. We got so excited about going.
Yeah, I mean... Right now, though, best worst case scenario kind of thing. Like, if we can get on the road this year, hopefully. I mean, I think our next place we're going to go is back up northwest and see Washington, Oregon, Idaho, Montana, and all that.
Canada.
Some of Canada. You know, we love it up there, and we want to, there's so much more we want to see.
That was kind of our plan for the summer.
That was the plan, anyways.
Yeah.
So we're
spend like 3 months
hoping
up there.
To still get up there. But after that, we were thinking about doing like in wintertime, Europe trip with the Christmas markets and all that. That's still in the idea building stage right now, but we're hopeful that we can
we're hopeful we'll get to do one of those three things. Maybe find a way to do all three.
Yeah.
We really don't know, but we really want to go to South America. We want to go back to Europe. We'd love to go to Asia. We just don't have enough time off to go there right now because we want to go for a longer period of time. So... It's all up in the air.
There's a long list of stuff we want to do. But
we might find a place we've never even thought of going. That might be where we go next. So who even knows?
Never know. We really hoped you guys enjoyed our first ever Q&A and found something in there that was helpful to you, because that's our ultimate goal, is to help you guys travel.
So even though none of us can travel right now, we're hoping that we can still create helpful videos during this time to help you guys plan a trip or to help you guys travel when we can all actually travel again.
Yeah.
So our next Q&A video, we'll probably have some other videos before this one, but our next Q&A video will be a van life Q&A. So we've already had quite a few questions. We've also had some random questions just about us, so we might just do a random question about us Q&A. So if you have any van life questions or want to know anything about us,
whatever,
anything, random stuff, it's fun. Please comment below and let us know. But yeah, we hope you guys enjoyed this. Sorry if we talked a lot. This was
We tried to keep it short,
but we get excited and
we like talking about it. So
we will see y'all next time. Stay healthy, wash your hands.